It's a real honor to introduce this rite of passage here for G, who has had really quite an incredible career here at the Media Lab, starting her work on paper circuits with Leia when Leia was here at the Media Lab, and then coming to my group and really expanding into all kinds of areas with this idea. You know, G's wonderful, blinky, LED, beautiful artworks kind of graced our walls all over the lab for a while. We've all enjoyed that. But then G went and developed with Bunny these stickers, idea of putting electronics on stickers that turns heads everywhere, not just in the art community, but also when I go to technical conferences, people just love this idea. There's something profound about it somewhere. And G has gone further by engaging with educational communities, dealing with crowdsourcing, letting the whole world produce these things and use them, and then take the information back to build her research. And in many ways, it's a great model for this kind of work. So I'm delighted to introduce G, and let's hear more detail. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, cool. Thank you for that intro, Joe, and thank you to everyone who is joining me today, and to my committee, Joe, Edith, and Leah, for supporting me through all of this. So without further delay, here goes. My thesis is titled Paper Curiosities, Circuits on Paper for Learning and Expression. And the idea is actually about the combination of paper and electronics. And what that means to me is building circuits on paper using arts and craft techniques blended with electronic components, so functioning circuitry. And I first encountered this in a project that was an electronic pop-up book that I made as Europe for Leah many, many years back. And with this project, I got to combine two things that I really loved, paper craft and circuitry and engineering. And what happened was the paper became even more magical because it was suddenly interactive and I could make it do all sorts of things like light and sense. But also the circuitry, the electronics, the interactivity became more meaningful in the context of a crafted scene. And I've been really wanting to share this with everyone, this way of making, with as many people as possible ever since that special time for me. And what I'm really sharing is this idea, this feeling, this experience of wonder, where you are so caught up in this amazing thing that you literally physically pause and your senses heighten so that you can learn more about what's going on. And this is what inspires curiosity for us to learn more about our world. And how wonder happens is when we encounter a surprise. So you're going along your everyday routine, but then something different happens, something unexpected happens, and that's when you actually stop and pay attention. And this is a beautiful example from Bruno Minari, which takes these ordinary river stones, but then adds these adorable drawings that turn a scene into a rainforest with a monkey or a river with a person in it. And it reminds us that everywhere in the world, there's more than what you think is there. The world is filled with magical possibilities. But wonder is more than just surprises. If every time you were surprised or you encountered something new, it turned out to be a harmful, dangerous experience, then instead of feeling wonder when you encounter the new, you start to feel fear, which is the opposite. Your senses shut down and you run away to safety. And that's really important here as we introduce new combinations. I'm hoping to introduce wonder and not fear by using familiar materials like paper as we introduce this potentially intimidating world of electronics to people. And just a simple example. Oh, let me go back and play. There we go. A simple example of a paper electronic circuit is this pressure sensor. So there's your battery, that's your power supply. We have copper tape to act as the wires. There's two red LEDs and then one little handcrafted pressure sensor. The harder you press, the brighter the light. Very simple. And that's the electronics portion, but you add a little drawing and it completely changes things. So here's a character. When you give him some love, he blushes and loves you back. And it's just a drawing. But you can see when you combine these two together, the drawing comes to life, the circuitry takes on this whole other layer of meaning, and that's what I have been, that I hope to share with you more of this, things like this today. The point is the meaning that comes out of this combination. So this builds on a large body of work in toolkits, in using alternative materials, craft materials to build circuits, like conductive Play-Doh or conductive inks. There's the lily pad toolkit, and which is for making circuitry using textiles, made by Leah. Also the teardrop toolkit, which is uses magnetic modules for interfacing with paper and circuitry. My focus today is going to be on paper, obviously, in this space. And then there's within that, there's also lots of research going on in terms of printable circuits, in terms of even turning these printed circuits into energy harvesting devices so that we can power our circuits in new ways. There are people creating devices that interface with these printed circuits and turn them into sensors, like this story clip. But I want to take these new processes outside of the lab and out into the world. And so in that space, two really cool examples are the CircuitScribe pen and AGIC, which are both conductive ink pens that allow us to draw circuits with conductive ink. One thing I'll be focusing on is accessibility. So the bulk of the materials I use are things that you can find everywhere. So rather than specialized pens, we're thinking conductive tapes and foils that you can find in your hardware store. And these are two examples of the kinds of things that you can make with paper-based circuitry. On the left is the Tide Notebook by Natalie Fried. It's a book that has lights in it that actually show you live updates of the current tides. And it is connected via Wi-Fi to national weather data. So it's right in your book, really cool. The other is an example of a poster that changes color and reveals more information as you actually physically interact with it. And both of these are beautiful examples, and I want to make it so that anyone, everyone, can have access to this sort of interactivity, this sort of capability, and the things that they create, and not just amazing experts like these folks. So, stepping back a bit, why paper? Well, first, it is familiar to many of us. It's the thing that we start to learn on. And so that means it's accessible mentally and emotionally. You already know it, so you're not scared of it as much. Also, the materials are, the techniques are familiar. They're paper is friendly to work with by hand, and many of us have. Next, it's flexible, as in paper itself comes in many different forms. It can be soft like fabric, it can be rigid like cardboard, you can draw on it, which means you can really change it, shape it to make it your own. At the same time, it's also a precursor to many other mediums. We often prototype and draft on paper before we move into other, perhaps more challenging to use mediums. So, that's in terms of flexibility. And the last is shareability, which for me means it is portable, so you can bring it to different places, show it to people. It is also mass producible. In fact, print publishing is on paper, and that was specifically made to share. It is also ubiquitous. Paper is everywhere. It's you can get access to it, and it's relatively affordable. So these are all really wonderful qualities of paper that, when combined with electronics, makes a whole different medium that I hope will change the way we learn, express, and communicate with each other. So that brings me to my research question. So given this new medium, how does it enable us to learn in new ways, both circuitry and electronics and beyond, so in the education space? Second, how does it function as a new expressive medium? How does it allow us to tell our stories in new ways? Does it? And finally, how does it engage new communities in creating technologies, especially those who might not otherwise participate? So these are my questions. And the remainder of this presentation is divided into three parts. So I will be first sharing my own design explorations in the form of books with circuits in them, and then this toolkit called Circuit Stickers. Then there's the evaluation of those research questions. And then finally, a small bit about what's next. So, starting with design. My own explorations, I looked at paper electronics through the lens of books, and this informed very deeply the design of the toolkit later on. So first, books are great for documenting and experimenting. I love personally love to use sketchbooks, and I found that one way to make a book even better for paper circuitry is to turn the whole book into a power supply. One way to do that is you clip a battery to one side, in this example, or you can even embed a rechargeable battery into the cover that is more environmentally friendly. And all of this allows you to create circuits and prototype anywhere that you can take your sketchbook, which I think is really fun. But the easiest way to have a sketchbook for circuitry is not necessarily to hack the book itself, but just build circuitry in notebooks or build them in different cards and then put them in a binder in book form. So that's what we ended up kind of going with. I also explored books' abilities to share information, first to tell stories. So this is a collaboration with Sonia DeBoer, an illustrator. We came up with a story, the entire story, and then created a picture book around it that used circuitry to tell about the character. And so here you can see it's about Ellie, the LED light, and she dreams to be a star. And so you can see by using programming and lights, we can change the patterns and express Ellie's emotions through light patterns. And so I will leave this story there. You can ask more about that later if you're curious. In addition to telling stories, it can give books can give us information for learning and teaching. So this project is an early collaboration with Natalie Fried Adams at a Penn called Telescrapbook, where there are two remotely connected scrapbooks that use these stickers, which are sensors and actuators, outputs, that learners can put right in the book. And the book has all this pre-created circuitry that makes it easy for them to build the circuit and then build these remote communication devices that they can then personalize. And this I will go back to later when I talk about the toolkit. And then finally, I made a book that explains paper circuitry in kind of how I discovered it, first through the materials, then introducing the circuitry, then there's like a lesson on soldering, and finally examples of circuits that will work and circuits that don't work. And these last two projects most greatly informed the design of the toolkit, which I'm about to share. It's the circuit stickers toolkit. So starting off, I had been teaching workshops, and in these workshops, it was very important for me to be able to use materials that learners can then take home or get by themselves, because they need to be able to do all of this at home, not just in this special workshop space. That meant using only standard materials and components that were commercially available, and for us, it meant using these little awesome flat surface mount LEDs. They're flat and easy to integrate with paper, that's why they're so great, but you'll notice they're also the size of a grain of rice. So if you blow on one and it disappears in the ground, it's just gone forever. It's not really made for humans necessarily. So from this was part of the inspiration for the stickers part of the Telescrapbook project. But what happened is that these stickers, while they worked really wonderfully, it took 3 grad students all afternoon to make like 12, which wasn't really scalable if you want to use this as a creative medium. But a few years later, everything changed. I met my awesome collaborator, Bunny, and he took a bunch of us to Shenzhen to investigate manufacturing and how we might use research at scale to learn. And this ended up starting off a collaboration in which we recreated these stickers, but using manufacturing processes. So we took flexible circuit boards, added conductive adhesive to the bottom, and then stamped the stickers out. So these are all existing manufacturing processes, but we wove them together in a new way to create these stickers. And they worked, and it was amazing, and it was awesome. So once we proved that it was technically possible, thank you, we then designed the most basic pieces, you know, which would let us go the most with the fewest different modules. So this ended up being a bunch of LEDs, then sensors, light sensor, sound sensor, and then these effects, which are these pre-programmed stickers that make your lights blink or fade or twinkle, just do different light patterns by just connecting an LED, so no programming. And this was the on-ramp to the world of programming, because you know, you might think, how do I make my blink faster? Well, you code. So that was the idea. And finally, we had a microcontroller that you could program. along with the stickers themselves, I then created this circuit sketchbook based on all my book experiments that had templates that learners could basically color in the lines with their circuit and build actual functioning circuits in the book. Each chapter also came with a little drawing. So after you create the technical bit, there was an image for you to tell a story. And each of the images were incomplete. So you have to add your story to finish the scene. And following each of these activities is open space for you to explore and design your own circuit, because that's where a lot of the real learning happens. So that's the circuit sticker sketchbook. In addition, to create as many different avenues to approach this as possible, I also made video tutorials. We made online web page tutorials, and then put all of those on our website so that everybody could access them. So now that we have all these resources, how do we get it out into the world? Well, two ways. First was a crowdfunding campaign through a website called CrowdSupply. It was awesome. We blew past our goal of $1, and it was great. Very quick, first hour, and then maybe about 6 months later, we shipped these amazing kits out into the world with with lots and lots of help from the lovely folks over at AQS and Bunny, who's a miracle worker. So these kits went out to the world, and they're currently still available through Chibitronics. We created a company to kind of support the legal and financial logistics of distributing so many physical artifacts all over the world. So these are still available out today. The second way of sharing this with the world was in collaboration with a nonprofit called NextMap, NCB2. And we started this initiative called the 21st Century Notebooking Initiative. There are two amazing people who headed that. One was David Cole, and one was Jennifer Dick, who I think is in the audience. Hello. And they were inspired by the work in the powered notebooks. And they wanted to look at how to add narrative to notebooks with technology, with circuitry. And they even created their own book, Circuit Sketchbook, with templates, except this was geared toward educators. So there's like classroom activities, learning concepts. And they even organized this amazing day called Hack Your Notebook Day, along with in collaboration with the National Writing Project, where I think 18 different sites across the US all created paper circuitry together. We had online webinars with educators where we shared our tips on how to do things. There was classrooms coming in sharing what their students were doing. Here's somebody who taped a circuit to his hand. Thought it was sweet. And then they also shared what they were doing through Twitter feed. So everybody was kind of all over the US, but creating together. And this also, they started an online community called 21st Century Notebooking. And now educators, not just English teachers, but also physics teachers and math teachers and others, are sharing what they're doing. And it's beautiful. So thank you so much. So that was the first bit, what we created. But now, looking at how does paper electronics, now that it's out in the world, how does it measure up? So first, I was interested in the learning space. You know, how does it enable us to learn in new ways? What new things are we learning? And my approach here was a qualitative approach. I interviewed 20 educators who had 1 to 5 years of experience with paper electronics. So these were people, some were early collaborators, some were people who I found contributed a lot of resources to paper electronics online or in print. They were middle school teachers, high school teachers, librarians, museum facilitators, makerspace directors, after school program directors, like all sorts of people, educators. I also collected documentation and resources by these people. And together with all of this data, I analyzed and found some interesting themes, tons of themes. I will only share a few here. You can find more in the thesis. The first was this magical light bulb moment. And that is when, in a workshop, someone for the first time lights up a little circuit on their paper. And it's just this surprise. You hear like gasping, sometimes you hear like clapping, and then suddenly everybody's looking over, and then everybody else is like, oh, I can do this. And it's just a really exciting moment in every kind of learning experience. And one educator said that, I love the light bulb moment for students or teachers in workshops, especially when they were like me, first intimidated, but then empowered. And so I think what makes this work is that because it's such a kind of a quick success, a quick and early success, there's only so many things that will go wrong. And so by the end of a workshop, pretty much everybody's got a functioning circuit. It's proof that you can do it. And that's motivation that to explore further. Another educator, an art educator, shares, it's not just the wonder over this tiny sticker lighting up. There's also magic in, I understand this, I can do this. It's paper, there's so much I can do with paper. So what she's pointing to is there's that sense of wonder, that here's this material suddenly doing something new that we was talking about earlier. But there's also wonder at yourself, seeing yourself doing something that you hadn't, that you didn't know was possible, and seeing skills that you already had suddenly be able to be applied to this whole new world is also really wonderful. So that was the light bulb moment. But so what are some things that they're actually doing in the classroom? So here's an example of using paper circuitry to tell stories. So here's an interactive storybook. Another popular activity is to light up poetry, often with light themes, with actual light, but also writing about light. And another English teacher, she actually made this hybrid activity about both about electricity and light, but also about the Great Gatsby. So she used light metaphorically as a way for her students to do literary analysis. And they had final projects that involved actual light, but also kind of looking at the light and dark themes of this novel. And so one educator put it really nicely, this blend of literacy and circuitry. He said, it becomes more metaphorical. Instead of using letters, the students are using circuitry to do the same critical and abstract thinking. They're making decisions about the circuit, and those decisions are entirely their writing. And what I think is really poetic about this is that writing and circuit making are both ways to make marks on paper. They're ways to communicate your ideas. They're even ways to think about ideas to yourself. And I thought that was fascinating, especially since he found that it was hard to get students to start writing a poem. But if you told them that they were going to light up their poem, suddenly they were excited. And then they eventually wrote the poem. It was great. So that's one theme. Another theme, so by having a medium that allows educators to blend so many different ways of learning and concepts, it serves a lot of teachers in unique spaces. So one example is Nicole First, who is a teacher educator. She works with educators all across the state of Alaska. And oftentimes you have one teacher teaching kids in a district the size of Ohio, and it's because everybody's so remote. And because of that, one teacher has to kind of teach everything. And so when you have something like the paper circuitry, they can actually do that without being overwhelmed. And in fact, and without being intimidated themselves. So I thought that was really, really wonderful. Here's an example how even there's a lot of remote teaching. So one teacher could be in Wisconsin and her class is in Alaska, and that's how they roll. But access is an issue. One youth program director shared, there are a lot of schools that use circuit stickers, but most colleagues are in private schools with enormous budgets. They have funds to be able to afford them. It's troubling because all youth should have access to these latest tools. And it is a true issue. So for example, a single circuit sticker LED is about $1, whereas a regular LED is about 10 cents. And that is huge and something that I struggle with. But luckily, because paper electronics is such an open, agnostic medium, you can actually take a regular LED, bend it out. And here's a fun example. They took a circuit sticker template, took a regular LED, and then put it down. And while you lose some of the qualities of the sticker, it works for them. And I thought that was actually really wonderful. So in addition to finding new blends of techniques and materials, teachers are also making their own tools. So here's a cool example of a tool that splits copper tape really easily. And so now you get twice as much tape and really fast. That was clever. And they're also creating their own templates, in fact, their own languages. So here's a template from Colleen Graves. Where she used different kind of lines to show different parts of the circuitry, and she was inspired by a textile pattern. So I thought that was really cool. So even the template language is evolving. So now that we've seen that paper circuitry can serve educators in so many different ways, I wanted to see how far the medium itself could go in terms of aesthetics, in terms of expression. And so for this, we had an art exhibition where we had 22 artists create 18 original works. Each artist was given a kit of parts. So for example, canvas, alligator clips, stickers, but then they were invited to bring whatever other components or materials they wanted to. Everyone just started in the same place. They were asked to make a 12-inch by 12-inch artwork. The first group was six selected artists. So these were people who I handpicked because they had very deep experience and skills and existing practices in like jewelry making or children's book illustration. One was a book artist. And then I interviewed these people before, during, and after the process to learn how they came up with their concept, to learn how they created. The second group came from an open call, and we had three design and debugging sessions to support these artists. And most of them came from, for example, MIT. Some of them came from a paper electronics group that I had been running. And so to kind of give a wider breadth of works. And this is what they made. Some examples, not all of them. More in the thesis. So some people explored lines, some people drew pictures with the copper tape. There was abstract, there was representational work. Some people explored themes very deeply for them. So here's an example of a Bernie poster that you yelled at to activate. It was really fun. It was a lot of yelling. His hair went crazy. and then there was nature themes. What's really cool here is actually there's two of these artists had very similar topics, but the look and what they're doing, the one octopus is holding a universe in a bottle, are totally different. And so you can see, even if you're starting with a similar theme, it's still totally personal to the artists themselves, and I think that's magical. So that's the works. What about the process? So I can't share everyone's process. They're all such interesting stories, but I'll share just three. So Becca Rose is a multimedia artist. She likes to draw, but she also does a lot of textiles, and she creates books. And her process was to let the material speak to her. She didn't really have an idea of what she wanted to do. And so instead of working on the canvas, she made herself a book. She made herself a sketchbook. And these are her process, her sketches as she went along. And she finally settled on some shapes and forms that she really liked, and eventually made this piece, which is the Curiosity of Rain, and where she the shapes and the lines of the circuitry kind of work together to create this dynamic rain effect. And she also uses the effect stickers to actually make them twinkle. So that was Becca. The next artist is Yael Friedman, who is a jewelry designer. And her work, it's kind of like art jewelry, is mostly complex printed, 3D printed mechanical devices that are you play around with. They're like puzzles, basically. And when she approached this, she basically made a bunch of beautiful prototypes like these. But she told me, you know, gee, I'm not happy with any of these because I don't understand why I put light in any of this. And so she eventually came up with this pendant, and she explained to me, okay, so I found that when you light the folds, they look different. And so for her, she finally found a way to make it work, which is that she made this pendant that has all these intricate folds that are highlighted by the light inside. And that was the only way that she was satisfied. And she shared at the end, you know, it wasn't that the circuitry was hard to do, it just didn't conceptually make sense, and so I don't think I will use lights in my jewelry. However, she did then add, but I'm really interested in motors, because I realized maybe instead of having physical, you move the jewelry, maybe the motor can do it. So it really depends on, you know, the artist's actual practice. I thought that was a neat example of that. So I think now she's doing some cool stuff with actuators. And the last example is Kay Feistiel. She's a children's book illustrator, and she kind of had an idea from the very beginning. She was inspired by a comic about a book with ticks growing on its back, and she wanted to represent that using paper circuitry. And so she experimented with materials to get the effect she needed. She sketched, designed, she made a full Frankenstein prototype is what she called it, that had basically a patch of fur and then some little drawings of buildings to prototype the interaction. And this was her final work, which is a puppy so overrun by ticks that they built a city on its back. And when you pet it, it lights up the windows, and that illuminates the picture in the back, so you can see what's happening in the characters in the windows. And so each one is a tiny little story, basically. And I thought the aesthetic also really, really conveyed her and the type of characters she uses when she illustrates. So that shows the breadth of the kind of works that you can create with paper electronics, but what about the people? Who is actually doing this, and is there also diversity in that space? So to do this, well, stay there, is we looked at Chibitronics as kind of a sample of the paper electronics community, because we had access to a lot of data. And first we looked at our sales data, so gender ratio of our based on who was ordering Chibitronics. First, there was our crowd supply campaign. That's the earlier portion. And then the middle and the right are from our website and from Amazon. So between the two, Chibitronics and Amazon, that makes up 60% of our sales by volume. So I think that is like a representative enough sample. What's interesting is that from our first campaign to now, the ratio flips from majority male to majority female. And I think it could be that when we first launched, it was kind of more of like an emerging technology, shown in a lot of kind of gadget-related blogs, things like that, which I think tends to be more male-dominated communities. But it's as Chibi has matured, we have more, it's become more of an educational and maybe even a craft supply. So I dive this into this a little bit deeper. I didn't have timestamp data for crowd supply, but I do have for us and Amazon, so I combined them, and then I looked at the ratio over the past 2 years in 6-month increments. And what's interesting here is actually the ratio of female customers is actually increasing. In fact, it like jumps in the past year, and like, where is this coming from? So my interpretation is from the following. So finally, after finding our ratios, we then looked at who is actually contributing websites about this stuff. And we did this analysis by looking at what websites are linking to Chibitronics through our analytics data. And then we broke that down by sub-communities. So this is kind of the makeup. Educators means teachers, librarians, museum, all those folks, basically people who engage in paper electronics for the goal of teaching someone else. That's their main purpose. Then we also had a lot of contributions from makers, and this is I define as the community of people who create for themselves but are more interested in the kind of the technical functionality than necessarily the artistic or aesthetic side. Then there's the crafters, and for us in this context, crafter means generally paper crafters, who are also creating for themselves, but very, very interested in the look, the aesthetic, the message of their creations. And so technology is just kind of yet another means to make those visions happen. So then the gender breakdowns of these is also really interesting. You know, it's very different depending on which community, although the total ratio is actually pretty similar to the sales data, so I think that's a good sign. But you'll notice that, for example, also to add, the unknown category is for folks that we couldn't, either we couldn't figure out, or they're from websites of organizations, so didn't really want to assign a gender to that. if you look at the maker community, we had 44% female contributions, whereas if you look at the crafter community, it was 98% female contributions. And so the crafter community is the one that I'm going to focus on. And it's also the community that kind of has popped up most recently in the past year. So what are they making? What are they doing? A lot of cards, first of all. So these are all cards from the crafters. And you'll notice that, at least what I believe, is that all of these have technology in them. All of these have six circuits. They're lighting, they're glowing, they have switches. They're pretty cool in that sense. But they don't scream technology. They scream cards first. And that's one space. And then moving beyond cards, we also see crafters make really complicated three-dimensional things, like these models or this box or this light up scene, or moving on to other materials entirely. So decorating, for example, this light up frame. And so they're moving beyond the cards, beyond the initial circuit, and even beyond two-dimensional is what I'm saying. And the other interesting thing to note is that a lot of these are documented as tutorials. Oh, full disclosure, some of these are mated by professional crafters, and these are people who get free materials from companies like us and make stuff. That said, we only give the materials, so all the design, all the creation, everything is them. So I think that's the important bit, and not all of them, some of them. But anyway, so a lot of these are in video tutorial format, and it's really interesting to see because it's always, if I ever wanted to make resources for crafters, I know exactly how to do it, basically. You show a full project from beginning to end and kind of in this way. And one really interesting thing here is one of the tutorials is titled How to Make an LED Card Without GBtronics, which is really fascinating. And she does it using surface mount LEDs and conductive silver paint. And what's awesome about this is that it means that she's maybe encountering the space of electronics plus cards and paper through Chibi, but it's a gateway. She's exploring beyond that, and I think that's really amazing. And she's even sharing, which is cool. So those are what we've seen, some reflections as a tool designer. So on the topic of familiarity, so I started with saying how many people understand how to start with paper, and that makes the art, these tools, accessible. But what I realize is that if you create a toolkit using only existing things, and by combining them together in new ways without getting rid of the properties of the existing things, you're not actually designing intuitively. People don't have to guess how to use something successfully. They actually have an intuition of all the separate parts. They don't need to learn the new bits. What's cool about that is that they might have a deeper intuition about those separate parts than even you, the designer, have. And that means that when they use these tools, they bring out aspects that you might never have imagined. That was amazing. The next kind of bit was flexibility. So the idea that these tools are enable people to really, really personalize in terms of both aesthetic as well as the process for how they do things. And this is kind of this, I think Mitch or many folks have come up with this idea of like wide walls and high ceilings. So we've mentioned that, you know, it's easy to get started, but also you can do so many different things, and they can be as complex or simple. And so by being able to make things that are so personalized, you make things that you care about. And that's really important and strong in the motivation. Flexibility also means open. Again, the example of people using different kinds of components, being able to create their own techniques, that's what makes the toolkit robust, I think. And finally, there's this idea of shareability. So how paper, for example, it's so portable, it's so light, you can actually show it around. So it becomes a social process, which is important as we create, as we learn. Also, everything that we've created is open in the terms of open source. Under Creative Commons, that means there's this idea that is legally open for you to share, explore, and remix, and that's also very important too as we kind of generate this new kind of community. We want to put that ethos out there, because that's what's causing all these new resources, new books, new templates. Everything's popping up because people are encouraged to do exactly that. So that is, those are some thoughts, but what's next? So I'm really interested, now that we've got our things controlled by electricity, how do we control them through programming or through computation? And the first bit is actually, how do we use materials to compute rather than words? So instead of describing, creating physical connections. And so this example prototype toolkit are these stickers that you actually link together. So there's a light sensor that, this is based on a sticker, gets dimmer as you make it darker. There's an, a logic module here, so you can connect the outputs from these light sensor in this tuner, which is a set voltage, into your logic. And when it's dark, the logic goes high. Then there's this record sticker, so that you can record a pattern. Instead of describing a pattern, you show it the pattern, record it, play it back. And when, so when you press play, it just repeats exactly what you did kind of physically. But then you can change up the connection. So you're literally drawing by sticking, or sorry, coding, programming by sticking, or programming by drawing. So now we're triggering the play. So that's the play by the light. And then finally, another example, I have a little pulse that tells you when one play is done. So if you take that around, bring it back to the beginning, it triggers itself and it will go in a loop and it will play continuously rather than one time. And what's cool about that is that you can, like, literally, it's almost like a graphical representation of starting all over, because there's a line there that shows it. And then you stop it by just disconnecting the line. So these are just some very early simple examples of how you might program by drawing. And it's all inspired by the idea of the modular synthesizers and things like that. But, so that's where that comes from. The second direction is, how do we make computation easier to integrate with paper? Right now, we have educators soldering electronics microcontrollers onto paper, but that's already a giant barrier. So this is in Chibitronics land, a new kit that comes with a board, a little monitor, and anyway, I'll just show you through these demos instead. How about that? So the idea, first of all, for the programming is that you use, instead of downloading software, there's a browser-based interface that we've collaborated with CodeBender to do. And so you can take your code, and then it connects to the board via audio jack. So all the information is going through an audio cable instead of a USB cable, which enables you to use things like a phone or a tablet or anything that can make sound to program your board. So you can see this example. And then I change up the code to make it blink faster. So you see that, like, orange light there blinks much faster afterwards. There's the update. And this is all many, many thanks to Team Bunny and Sean, who have made this amazing thing happen. The next part of this kit is the serial monitor, because, for example, phones don't have that, which computers do. So you can write text to this little screen that you can physically connect to the board. So that's the serial monitor. It's a little hard to see, but you can also use it as a voltmeter to measure voltage. So this is, you can press it down for a quick measure, but you can also use alligator clips for a more stable connection and measure different parts of your circuit, and use this cute little screen to read or write to. So those are kind of the hardware and programming bits. There's also the, you know, the paper side. So one idea is to turn this whole board into a clip, so you can clip it into your notebook. And it's important because we want to make this reusable, right? These are more expensive bits, so to be able to move it around is important. So here's an example circuit. And as with any paper electronics project, you can draw and make it into a story. But now, even though your picture can be the same and your circuit can be the same, you can rewrite your story by rewriting your code. So that's a really interesting dimension that I hope we can explore further. So now there's like a space invasion or something, I don't know, instead of a shooting star. And in addition to clipping to books, you can also use it as a clip to hold things together. So this is first as a clipboard. So you can make your circuit on a card, add the card to your board, and you have your functioning circuit. But you don't have to clip to just one card. You can also clip to many cards stacked on top of each other, and that allows you to make these books with circuits on the pages. And that kind of like brings us full circle back to the explorations in electrified books. So except now we're using our microcontroller as the binding of our book. So that's what I have to share for today. I just want to say thanks to all the amazing individuals that have made this possible, from earlier collaborators on circuit stickers to totally amazing Team Chibitronics, who put up with me, and the 21st Century Notebooking team, the educators out there who are doing amazing, inspiring work, and who've also shared their stories so that I can share them here with you today. To our Paper Curiosities crew and our artists, of course, and other many, many collaborators. Amazing Europe's who saved me over and over, and then to the lab for being so open with my shenanigans, and my research groups, Hilotech and Responsive Environments, and neighbors over in Lifelong Kindergarten for providing the intellectual and emotional and technical support to make all this happen. And finally, my friends and family and mentors who have kept me sane through the crazy, crazy adventures of these past few years. So thank you all for joining me.
Mm-hmm. Of course, it makes me think about this medium as a gateway.
Yeah.
You talked a bit about it with people making their own LEDs and things like that. But I mean, do you see people going from the medium you have into kits, Arduinos, making circuits, or do you see them just staying in the medium and just getting more complex within your medium itself? What with your population, what have you noticed?
That's really interesting. It depends. Yeah, it depends, because a lot of educators, for example, they start off with the stickers, for example, but then they move on to bare microcontrollers. They move on to smaller LEDs because they're actually smaller and integrate better. So I've seen that. I've seen an English teacher who started and never did anything with electronics, but then got really into it and then joined his local makerspace, and now he teaches a programming class at his school in addition to his English writing class. So that's definitely gone in that direction too. But I've also seen some of the crafters who are just so far happy with using kind of a set of circuits, but then taking it in all these crazy directions through the artwork. But then again, you also see crafters exploring the different materials too. So it's very broad, and I think it depends on the person.
That's great to see the possibilities. One other quick question. Getting back to modular synthesizers,
yeah.
Which are close to my heart, at least historically. There's a whole renaissance in that movement too.
Yeah.
There are more companies making them now than before, because they have a Eurorack standard. They can make some crazy
idea,
make a module, and people buy them and use them.
Yeah.
In some sense, you have a platform here. You may be the only vendor, but I wonder if you are. I mean, are there other people popping up that make modules that you could use with Chibitronics?
I don't know about modules that use with Chibitronics, but I know there are tons of also kits out there that use physical blocks, so little bits. That's like even before all this happened. There's a new kit out by Google. I don't remember the name, probably you guys know, but it's all about, Project Blocks, okay. Yeah, that uses tangible pieces that easily connect and allow you to program different functionalities. I don't know as much from the synthesizer and audio space.
So much the audio, but I mean, is it beauty just in what you do, and that you don't really have to go outside of this? You, people can just make their own stickers that do different things.
That would be cool.
Sell them and work with what you have.
Yeah, I'm actually, two things. I guess one thing I forgot to mention is that what's kind of unique about the sticker approach is that it still works with paper. I didn't show you, but you could expand that circuit to turn it into a skyline or something like that. And so that's one thing that's slightly different from what I think, what I believe anyway, are the more kind of brick-like kits out there. There's one remix of actual stickers out there, but it doesn't actually include new functionality, but it is stickers, it is light, so that's happening, ironically, in the craft community, which really shows that it sounds like it's a sound medium for that community, but not yet. I hope so, right? The whole idea is these are tools that are open so that people can contribute more types of pieces. That would be really awesome.
So we can open up in the committee. Any questions before we go to the floor? Edith?
Yes.
Congratulations. Thank you.
I will speak of the research part, the sort of bringing your contributions into the community and into the wild, as you say.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there is some questions to me as to the ways in which you use the information that you get from your users.
Mm.
And in reading the text, and I apologize because not everybody read the text, I felt that the part that was stronger is when you actually have artists like yourself, people who are more interested in the crafts, and who really know their medium, have their preferred medium, actually produce their own artwork, tell you what they have done, and let you observe the process. Because I felt that in this case, you use your users as consultants that actually inform in ways that push your own work and help you evolve your own work in ways that I cannot see when I read all the accounts by the educators. So for example, there is the woman called Yael Friedman. The way you tell the stories of what these people do, what they add, their puzzlements, is very important as a reader of your thesis, because they also challenge a little bit the limits of just producing nice cards that light up, because they have no time to explore the paper media for a long time. And they have no time to actually think, what if I gave movement to things, if I animated them in different ways than just lighting them up and so on. This is all potential that you have in the Chibitronics, but much of the research with the educators is very rosy. And it's rosy in the sense that much of the research at the Media Lab is rosy. Because what you show is, I have my favorite medium, it's paper. You actually don't do justice in this presentation to your own love for paper, which you did in a previous presentation. It's very personal to you. Why paper is so important. But then when you argue why paper is important, you give it quality that you could find in other media, like clothing, for example. You know, it's also portable, it's also flexible, and so on. So I have been puzzling a little bit with the parts of your research that I find very important, because it's real research, and it helps you and the people who are closer to actually your approach to the medium work as a community that helps evolve the design. And I think some of what the artists did is probably very related also to your next steps, which are so important, you know? It's like, why only lights? It could be other things, or maybe if I could program something, it would be more useful to me than just light up things. So that's my comment. And I have proposed in the text some
We're going to meet after, actually, to drill down into the document and all of that. So
the question is, it's not so much only to you, Jean, it's to the rhetoric of Media Lab, many Media Lab theses, where we are in the habit of producing something wonderful. And I think G went way beyond what other people did. You created the cup. You did it all. I mean, you are done. You are. the work on the general exam was fabulous because you have your own take on what creative thinking is about. And it was brilliant. But then all these students have to do their user studies. And it just doesn't quite fly. And I think it has to do with trying to show that if you show your offerings to educators, they are happy and get all the arguments of why they find it wonderful. Mm-hmm. So I just would like you to address your own, maybe very personal sense of which types of research or explorations with other people have actually helped you most in thinking what the next step are, what are the challenges and the limits of your offerings.
Okay.
Almost give a list of preferences, you know, the study with the other artists or the demographics of who used Chibotronics, which is more like market studies, or is it the study with education? Is there some kind of sense of preference or sense of greater relevance on some of these studies, because I think it will help others who work in the lab to just assert this part that is the most important to you also.
I guess if I were to make it very personal, the most important parts for me was to see actual impact, use. And so I guess the reason, let me preface all this, which is that there's so much out there that I was struggling to figure out how to collect all the data of all the things I wanted to learn. And so even for the educators, a very limited sample of people that I've either stalked or people that I know. So that could be where some of that rosiness comes from. That said, I've also just observed, and I hear there's actually a big, long list of wishes as well as complaints, which useful, but I think, and maybe this is a cop-out, but by the time we actually created this kit, it's not like I can just make all the pieces that I want anymore, because it has to be made in the thousands, in the tens of thousands. And the idea of, for example, having outputs other than light, we've been wanting to do that forever and ever and ever. In fact, for example, a piezo speaker is flat, and it works, and it's basically made for paper electronics, but we haven't been able to introduce that in the kit. That said, I think one of the things that I would like to be able to do somehow is to look at paper electronics as a whole, because while we may not have done this, there are people who have created and used speakers on their own. I think I'm struggling as a growing researcher to figure out the methods for how to access that sort of information, but that's what I'm interested in. And in this sense, like, this is basically an overview of this totally new kind of making, and so I can't go maybe as deeply as I would like to. I don't know if that helps.
More than a legitimate answer, because I don't have an answer to my own question.
Well, we can, we're going to meet with them, so we can take our time with G after if we'd like some of the details. Leah, anything, any short question for the Y community here?
In many ways, I think connected both to Joe's question and to Edith's comments and question. First, I want to say also congratulations. I mean, the work is so beautiful. Are you losing me?
No, you're back.
Ah, okay. So just the work is so beautiful and so impactful and so so impressive, so great. And so it's just been such a pleasure to get to know you and to be with you on part of this journey. So congratulations. So back to my question. I feel like there's so much richness here that you presented us with. And what I'm really wanting from you, both in this presentation and in the document, is like for you to be... to tell us what it means. So for you to interpret some of this spectacular kind of abundance of richness that you have like sparked and like brought to life. So one particular example, like that I'm especially excited about. So I look at, for example, the gender stats and the kind of work that crafters are doing. And I feel like, whoa, there's like a cultural change happening here. But I want you to like, tell me about that cultural change and also to think about like what in that change like is exciting and compelling to you. And then this is evolving into much more of a comment than a question. I'll say one more thing and then I'll let you talk for a bit. But when I look at the work that the crafters are doing, I feel both like delighted and tremendously excited, but also a little bit afraid. And the fear is that this work will be trivialized, that potentially there's a potential for like some of the barriers separating these like different ways of working are like to be dissolved and to be mashed up in really compelling, interesting cultural ways as well as kind of like working ways. But there's a fear that I think it's important to think about where the work that crafters are doing, people can just be like, oh yeah, all of a sudden that trivial, silly stuff that crafters do now has trivial, silly like lights in it. And the opportunity for like mashing up some of those boundaries and changing the way people think about like technology and craft and art, that there's a potential to lose those opportunities. So anyway, I just wonder if you could tell us more about like, what does this really mean in like big, massive like cultural themes or, you know, so to just take that forward to
big, massive cultural themes. Let me start more specific, which is you mentioned the crafters and what do I think that means? Well, one thing that came to my mind was like, look, if now suddenly, by the way, many of the bloggers that have shared their work are definitely mothers because they share, they talk about their kids, they make things for their kids. What if now you see both dad building electronics and mom building electronics, having that kind of role model, I think will change.
Extraordinary, and what it beckons people in this audience to do is pick pieces out of what you've been doing and dig deeper and do some research, and that's very exciting. You've shown that there's a lot of potential, and I love it. Thank you.
Thanks.
Good. We see you're motivated by Leah's questions. So we'll go into that later. But we got all kinds of interesting people here with questions. So.
Okay. What is the word? How did you come up with the name Chibitronics?
Easy one. So chibi means small and cute, I think, in Japanese. And basically, I wanted to think about what is the opposite of what many people think of electronics now. It's scary, it's dangerous, and it's only for experts. Whereas cute things are friendly. They're, in fact, helpless, so you're the one that is in control, and they're fun to play with. And so I wanted to make electronics feel that way so that people who think electronics aren't for them realize it can be when it's in this form. So that's Chibitronics.
More questions?
Possibly a difficult question, but I'll try to make it easy. So as people start getting more excited about embracing Chibitronics and doing more complicated things like, say, put motors into their circuit, and it requires more current.
Mm-hmm.
Have you thought about how to not to use a bad word, but for lack of a better word, insulate your circuits from heating up too much and going back on that societal acceptance of your safe circuits?
That's a really great question. In fact, it's something that I'm trying to figure out now for the new bits, because now we're using USB power and stuff. On that front, I feel like if people know what they're using, then it's not really dangerous. You use a soldering iron, you know not to touch the front, or you do it one time and you never do it again. That's fine. It's all learning. And so I feel like if we just let people know, and then it's okay. For example, in one of my tutorials, I have people cutting open a USB cord and using that for power because, frankly, your circuits get so much brighter, and people seem okay with that. But I don't know. This is very early, and I haven't done a lot with high power with actual questions and safety. So I'm not really sure. But I do think that it's better to show and share and educate than to just hide it away because you're really... It just stunts your learning, and it could be a wonderful lesson in current and resistance and voltage stuff too when you have more diversity of what you're working with. So that's what I would personally like to go to. I haven't figured out legally how I would do that, and there's all this other stuff, but I won't go into that.
Now, ideally, if you stay in the realm of the kit, it would be safe. I mean, coin cell's not going to do much on paper at this point. If some kid plugs it into the wall socket, I mean, she's not going to take liability.
No, inspire that. I don't know what to do with this.
A lawyer legal disclaimer, like we do on products.
Don't know.
Hopefully, we never get different. Go ahead.
You have some experience in the culture of today, which isn't quite ready for people putting some cards with circuitry in the mail, a fear of suspicion that it will explode and things like that.
Yeah.
And you have these things that you take into IDC and other conferences, and you show up to promote this, but you're also traveling on a plane. And you know, so there's a few people that do these things, and it's kind of hard to handle. So what advice do you have for my students and people to take these things and sort of get from here to there with it, where you can't really mail it, you can't bring it on the screen for fear, you know, that you have something that is negative when it's really a positive thing? Like, how do you manage? Do you just get everything when you show up at the conference? What kind of tips do you have for sort of promoting this kind of work and being safe in the process, given the culture that we live in, where there's a lot of suspicion around it?
Yeah, that, I have to admit, when I do this stuff, I generally just kind of, and I haven't had specific problems. I've been stopped, and when I am, I explain, and then usually they're okay. Or what I do is like, here, it's actually this really cool thing, and then I go into this long explanation about the project and why I love it, and then they're like told generally either fine or they're annoyed because I'm taking so long. So, I mean, that's an approach. I don't know if it's scalable, but you know, but. I'm paranoid, so I like to have all my things with me rather than, but I don't know, I guess it depends. I don't know about the mail. I think people have managed to send these through the mail, but maybe those are happy accidents instead of the norm.
Thank you for putting my name on the final
Thank you for your help.
So I have a question about like the electronic part of the speakers. Mm-hmm. I have to admit I didn't really check the website so like thoroughly. Like, mm-hmm. do you have like open like sales schematic or design platform or everything? Because I'm just curious. Like, actually, like circuit speakers not just something like for kids. It's also for us who has electronic background because mm-hmm. it's basically off-shelf flexible at Windows somehow, which is amazing to use in general. Like a programmer, mm-hmm. which is on paper and for lots of a little bit more advanced development that's very useful. I'm just curious whether if anyone like hack into your speaker and do something, maybe like wire something out and make it as a flexible circuit, or do you think that's an interesting way to explore making more like for people who want to have more advanced electronic engagement into your system?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. So first question is, yes, there's a wiki that has all the source files, the Gerber files for the electronics. The code is also on GitHub, so you can get that. That stuff is out there. It would be amazing to have more advanced, engineers create their own stickers. In fact, there's one collaborator, Owen, who was one of the artists. He reprogrammed our sensor stickers using this amazing, actually, wooden nail and screw contraption to actually get to the microcontroller on there. So people are doing really cool things. It's a good point about also the flexible. Owen actually said a similar thing, which was that, you know, as an engineer who builds tons of circuits, that's kind of his background, he would find it really cool to have all these modules to be able to easily, quickly hook them up, kind of modular sense style, because it doesn't really matter how big the circuit is, it matters that it functions, and maybe that modularity and accessibility through patching would be a useful thing. That would be very far into the future. If somebody does it, that would be amazing. Too. And that's the other thing, like all these units, because they're open, all the circuitry, everything is exposed, you can kind of intertwine different kinds of stickers or regular components or rigid and flexible boards. It's all open to that too. Spencer?
For people to make their own stickers, like how kind of difficult are, if you're doing a rigid PCB, like at this point there's so many services that can fab those for you, it's really easy. But for the stickers, because it's like a somewhat more specialized process, mm-hmm. Is creating your own stickers something that's pretty accessible to like the hobbyist electronic, hobbyist?
I think the hardest part would probably be the flex PCB, and I'm guessing one of the barriers would probably be cost, because I know they would cost more than regular PCBs do. But beyond that, it's not actually that different from a rigid board. And then to make it into a sticker, you can get the adhesive off like SparkFun or CrowdSupply, maybe other places, and you just literally stick it to the back. So the sticker part is pretty simple, and especially if you're doing it by hand, it's a matter of sticking. It's a little bit harder to do it at scale, I think. So I think as long as you have access to flexible boards, you can turn them into a sticker. That brings up the other point, is does a sticker have to be flexible? No, you could probably add the adhesive to a regular board, but I find that when you have a rigid thing and a soft thing interface, because that's the whole point of the flexible sticker, usually the soft thing will peel right off. But yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure if there's more barriers than that. I think Xiao had.
It's really great to watch your presentation and see everything all together. It's really a tour de force, so congratulations. So this question is perhaps a little bit unfair, and we've talked about it a little bit before, but I just wanted to raise the issue. So a few years ago, I think I told you about how I stuck at the Dallas airport, and I met a man by the name of Karong, who's from a very, very underprivileged area of Macon, Georgia. Mm-hmm. And he was telling me about his daughter and granddaughter, and I was like, oh, I'm going to send them Chibitronics and circuit mm-hmm. stickers and let them explore it. And I never really, I was sort of in touch with him afterwards, but never really heard about how it went with giving his daughter and granddaughter the stickers. And then it occurred to me that actually, even though like sending $50 to $100 for me wasn't a huge deal to give mm-hmm. it to them, having someone in that position had these electronic parts, it almost felt like in order to tinker with it, you have to be able to be willing to use the resources and to be able to throw it away if you mess up. But, and if you're from such an underserved community, you don't even have the money to buy just a few of these. And so I guess this is not in any way to diminish that the work you have done in expanding mm-hmm. access to electronics and these sorts of ways of engaging with technology, but I was just wondering if you had any more thoughts regarding this sort of issue.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's exactly the issue that I personally struggle with, professionally struggle with all the time, in the sense that I think right now there's the custom kits that I create. I agree, I wish they could just be made given to the world more freely. Unfortunately, physics doesn't quite work that way, but I think, well, one vision is different models. If we could make them at a much bigger scale, the cost would go down. Another possibility, we could do a nonprofit where, you know, some folks from the for-profit side help to subsidize the cost if we were to try to give these out. I don't know. I think there are creative ways to do it. The current solution, which is maybe not necessarily a solution, is to use different kinds of components, and that's what I've seen educators actually do up there. So, I mean, that's what I know right now. I mean, if there's some way to like maybe convert standard components into easy stickers by yourself, that could be a cool way to do it. I haven't really explored that. Maybe that could be an avenue. But I don't really have a good answer. Yeah.
And again, it's a hard question, so.
Yeah, I mean, we butt heads over this so much. Like, I wish they could be more affordable. We just put it that way. Krishan?
Yeah, one last. You have the last word.
I was gonna actually follow up on Spencer's question, and I was curious if people, so you did mention like Agic and the sort of inks and stuff. I was curious if one avenue towards people making their own stickers was printing that stuff at home, like you can mm-hmm. now print flexible electronics on a printer.
Yeah.
If you've seen anybody doing that, or even just taking, like, if you were to take your designs and make them single layer so they could be printable in addition to viable, if you would maybe see more up people taking up DIY fabrication.
It would be certainly worth trying. I think, like, sure. I don't know what would happen, though, I guess, because we haven't actually done that. But I think if there were enough people printing their own circuitry, as one way of finding flex, that would be really awesome. I mean, I guess we could. I don't know what would happen. I also feel, though, that ultimately the printed circuitry is more niche and more commercial and perhaps more research right now than more of a DIY. That said, there are conductive paints, and so if you wanted to hand do these, it is definitely possible. Like, you could absolutely do that right now. So that's one way to do it. I haven't seen examples personally, but they might be out there. Because we run into the issue, if you are putting all this work just to make a raw material in order to create something else, it the timing and the effort, because I've done that, it doesn't quite work out, but it's fun. And so maybe there are folks who are doing that and I'm just not aware of it. So, yeah. But that's a cool idea. It's a good suggestion.
So on that note, let's thank G.